Last month, the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change released its most recent report, and it will surprise no one after this summer's fires and floods that it contains some tough news. But less noted was some cause for optimism. With us now for more, two of the climate scientists who contributed to the report. In Victoria, British Columbia, Greg Flato, Senior Research Scientist at Environment and Climate Change Canada and Vice President of the IPCC's Working Group 1. And in Atlanta, Georgia, Kim Cobb, Professor in the School of Earth and Atmospheric Sciences at the Georgia Institute of Technology and one of the lead authors of the IPCC's Working Group 1. And we're delighted to welcome both of you to TVO tonight. Greg, perhaps we could start by having you take us through what you think are the main findings of the report.
Okay, well, I think the main findings are that climate change that we have been experiencing is changing rapidly. It's changing in ways that are unprecedented in at least 2,000 years. That we know why the climate is changing. It's indisputable that human activities are causing the changes in average temperature, causing changes in extremes, both the intensity and frequency of various extreme events. And that it is the future pathways of emissions that will determine the extent of warming, the extent of changes that we will see going forward.
Kim, I've heard this question asked, and I'm sure you have heard it asked many times, but let's put it to you anyway. The Earth's temperature has varied before. What makes this time different?
Well, this definitely hits on my core expertise in paleoclimate, the study of climate of the past. And what makes these current periods so exceptional are three things. The global extent of the warming that we're seeing is unusual in the context of the last several millennia. The rates of warming are also relatively unusual. Remember that we know it took 10,000 years to warm from the last ice age, which was a 5 degrees Celsius change. And last but not least, we know the levels of current warming are also highly unusual. We have to go back, in fact, 120,000 years or more to the last interglacial period to see global temperatures warmer than they are today.
So in fact, this time it's different.
It's different.
The report also highlights some pathways to manage some climate risks. Kim, do you want to take us just through some of the highlights of that?
Yes, so very important to note that the IPCC Working Group 1 is policy relevant, but really not policy prescriptive. But having said that, some very actionable information contained in the report, and most notably a region-by-region breakdown of the kinds of climate impacts that are, of course, already upon us and will accelerate in coming decades, giving communities and policymakers really relevant information to chart a course for climate-ready communities, as well as understand just the risks that are at stake right now with respect to emissions choices in the next decade or two. Number two, the important information contained in this report outlining warming levels across the century tied to specific emissions choices and helping us understand that that most ambitious target of 1.5 degrees Celsius still within reach if dramatic and sustained actions are taken this decade.
Well, I think that leads to the next thing that we want to talk about, which is the hopeful path that this report likes to put us on. And here's an excerpt from the report that I'll read now, which suggests that despite the precarious position the planet's in, it's not hopeless. Here we go, a reason for hope. Deliberate removal of carbon dioxide, CO2, from the atmosphere could reverse some aspects of climate change. However, this will only happen if deliberate removals are larger than emissions. Some climate change trends, such as the increase in global surface temperature, would start to reverse within a few years. Other aspects would take decades, for example, permafrost, thawing, or centuries, for example, the acidification of the deep ocean, to reverse, and some, such as sea level rise, would take centuries to millennia to change direction. Okay, so Greg, this has, you know, obviously profound implications here, and Canada has said that it is committed to moving towards a net zero emission situation by the year 2050. Let's pick that apart. Net zero emissions means what exactly?
Well, net zero emissions means that we have stopped the forcing that is driving temperatures to increase. So if you think about the car analogy, if your foot is on the gas, the car is going to keep accelerating. The only way to get the car to stop accelerating is to take your foot off the gas, and if you want it to slow down, to put your foot on the brake. So temperatures will continue to rise as long as emissions of greenhouse gases, particularly carbon dioxide, continue to be put into the atmosphere, because carbon dioxide lasts for a very long time once it's placed in the atmosphere. So only by halting those emissions and getting to zero or net zero, which is the combination of emission reductions plus some removals to offset the difficult to mitigate emissions of things like methane from agriculture, then you get to a situation where you can stabilize temperature at some level.
Well, help us understand that a little better, because I think probably people can't imagine a situation where we're not emitting anything noxious into the atmosphere, but the flip side of somehow being able to mitigate that by doing other things. What are those other things that we can be doing?
Well, there are ways that carbon dioxide can be removed from the atmosphere. There are natural processes that take carbon dioxide out of the atmosphere and store it in land and in the ocean. And those processes continue to operate today as they did all the time in the past. The difficulty is that we're putting more carbon dioxide into the atmosphere than those processes can keep up with, and so concentrations are rising in the atmosphere. So ways that we could reduce that are, first of all, to stop emitting in the first place or reduce our emissions, to do things that would enhance the ability of the natural system to take carbon dioxide up, or to introduce technological means whereby we extract carbon dioxide from the effluent of fossil fuel-fired plants, for example, or directly capture it from the air and store it underground in geological formations, things like that. So there are a number of things that can be done, at least theoretically can be done, but at this point, those technological type of interventions are still really in the pilot phase.
Let me follow up with Kim Cobb on that, because Greg did say theoretically. So I wonder how close we are from moving from theoretically to actually being able to do that on a sustainable basis.
Tough question indeed. We may have seen the news this week of a new pilot facility for direct air capture of carbon dioxide opening in Iceland. This would be such a small fraction of the total CO2 that's in the sky to be virtually negligible. And it's quite costly as well. And so for now, again, as Greg was saying, the most important thing we need to do is to reduce the emissions, the input of these carbon greenhouse gases into the sky in the first place. And second of all, most importantly, make sure that those natural sinks that have been working so hard for us over the last decades, basically saving us from 50% of the emissions that we've put up into the sky, coming back down into the land, into the atmosphere, into the ocean, are intact and that they are healthy going forward. This includes the rainforests of the world, which unfortunately were turning the knob in the wrong direction, moving to deforest so much of the rainforest that it's contributing 10 to 15% of the emissions that we are creating every single year. And so again, making sure that we keep those ecosystems intact to serve as natural sinks, just as important as thinking about emissions reductions, just as important as thinking about how quickly we can scale these very new and relatively expensive technologies to reverse some aspects of our emissions in coming decades.
And Kim, let me follow up with you again on the excerpt I read from your report just a moment ago. We suggested that if we did some good things, we could see some relatively quick signs of improvement. There are other things, however, that could take years or even centuries to improve upon. Okay, so the question is, how quickly might the warming of the planet stop if we were to move in relatively short order to do some of the things that the report suggests?
Well, it's really important that the public understand this. What we're fighting for is the ability to limit warming to 1.5 degrees Celsius by mid-century. That implies two things. We still have some increments of warming to come, and we know all of the impacts that come along with that thanks to the new science in the IPCC report. What we're doing in acting quickly towards achieving that kind of maximum of warming is frankly reserving the right to cool later this century. The trajectories of the most ambitious pathways in the new report do in fact show cooling throughout the latter part of the 20th century, something that we weren't certain we could achieve several years ago with the science. And so now we're able to say that that's a pathway we could walk if we so desire, but again, the next decade, critical choices about our emissions pathways that would either make that out of reach or, of course, make the warming levels higher by mid-century, together with all of those impacts along with it.
And can I get you to speak to one more thing, which is you can imagine the layperson saying 1.5 degrees Celsius warming. Well, that doesn't sound like very much. It doesn't sound like it would have much of an impact at all. Can you explain why it is actually extremely impactful?
Yes. I mean, I think people can understand where we are right now and the fact that we are currently reeling from so many climate-fueled natural disasters around the world that are gripping our headlines. With this new United Nations report, stronger physical links to drought in drought-prone regions like the Western United States and the Mediterranean, fire-prone weather in those areas piling on to create the kind of conditions that we see on the ground right now in the headlines, where people are losing lives, livelihoods, and landscapes that will be transformed for decades to come. So what we can do now is link these extremes to the current levels of warming. 1.1 degrees Celsius is where we are parked right now. And we're talking about adding an additional 0.4 degrees Celsius onto the warming rates, the warming levels that we are right now, and bringing that whole basket of climate change impacts up several more notches from where we are. So this is the problem. The climate system is very sensitive to these levels of global warming. And if we don't like where we are, we certainly don't want to see a doubling of warming to a 2 degrees C level warming or more.
Understood. All right, Greg, I want you to take us back about 6 years when Canada, along with nearly 200 countries, signed the Paris Climate Agreement. And it committed us and all those other signatories to do various things to fight climate change. I wonder if you could tell us, in your judgment so far, how well we have done in living up to those commitments we made in the Paris Climate Agreement.
Well, the Paris Agreement was unique in the sense that it allows countries to set their own nationally determined contributions to reducing emissions and to halting climate change. So after the Paris Agreement, countries one after another rolled out their initial plans, their initial levels of ambition, as Canada did and most other countries did. But the important part of the Paris Agreement is that it has this mechanism to ramp up the level of ambition. There is something called the global stocktake, which is every 5 years following the Paris Agreement, there is a stepping back and looking at how much we accomplished, what have we done, where are there still challenges, what more needs to be done, how could we do more? And that's really the key to the Paris Agreement, is this constant ratcheting up of ambition. And a number of countries, including Canada, have very recently announced additional targets, more stringent targets, more ambitious action to limit climate change. And that's exactly how the Paris Agreement is intended to work. But of course, it takes time for these announcements to be turned into action, and that action to ultimately be turned into emission reductions.
Now, I appreciate that, but how do I put this? I'm really not trying to get you mixed up in the current election campaign. I'm really not. But this issue has come up over and over again in the current election campaign. And so having you here, I want to do a little fact checking. It has been alleged that the current government has not met a single climate target agreed to in the Paris Climate Agreement. True or false?
Well, yeah, I mean, I'm not a policy person, I'm a science person, and the targets that have been announced are targets for years like 2030 and 2050, which, of course, are still in the future. And what the IPCC report and the previous special report on 1.5 degree warming showed very clearly is that in order to achieve the low levels of warming, like 1.5 or 2 degrees, we have to get emissions down to something like half of their level globally by 2030 and get to net zero by around 2050. So that's the trajectory that is required if we want to keep temperatures below 1.5 or 2 degrees, which is in fact the Paris Agreement target.
Okay, and Kim, I'll make the same admonition to you. I'm really not trying to get you mixed up in US politics, but we well remember that the US was in, and then the previous Republican administration took the US out of the Paris Climate Agreement. Where's the U.S. now?
Well, we are in. And obviously, the current administration places a high priority on climate action and is moving through a discussion on the budget for the United States that would really chart a path towards very aggressive emissions reductions in the very near term, over the next 15 years or so, if some of these aspects of our infrastructure bill pass. What is most notable as well is the administration's action to bolster the resilience of communities across America to harness this newly available science and make it actionable to keep communities safe as we continue to warm. Obviously, a lot on the line in the United States, a new role for climate action, something that I hope greatly as a scientist who has been working on this for decades, we come to see the kind of immediate sustained emissions reductions, because the early aggressive action is exactly what is required. That's what brings warming levels to our lower level. Later and less is not what is in the formula for keeping warming levels to a minimum this century.
No, I take your point, but as you look around the world, what do you see in terms of other countries which have signed the Paris Agreement in terms of their living up to the spirit and the letter of what they agreed to?
Well, I think, you know, I'm not a policymaker as well, as Greg said, but, you know, the disruption that COVID has brought into our lives is apparent in terms of some of the lessons it might hold going forward, especially as we approach these ratcheting up of ambitions in terms of what's truly possible. Many countries thinking about economic stimulus packages, infrastructure investments, job packages to boost their economies in a post-COVID world, and thinking about how to center the kinds of low carbon energy technologies and climate action into those bills is obviously critical. And COVID helping us understand just how quickly things can change, even in the best laid plans, and that it's critically important to get going right now.
Here's a weird question for you, Greg. Is there a small part of you that appreciates, not the death, obviously, what COVID did to this world? We had clear skies in a lot of places that we never used to have clear skies in, because so many people couldn't pollute in the way they used to. So a part of you that kind of appreciates that?
Well, it's hard to frame it as appreciation, but it is the case that the economic slowdown, the fact that the transportation sector was slowed down remarkably, from air transport to vehicle transport to truck transport, that industrial activity slowed down, especially in the early parts of the COVID pandemic. And that did lead directly to improved air quality in a number of places that consistently suffer from poor air quality. So it illustrated very clearly that action on emissions not only is helpful for reducing emissions that lead to warming, but lead to a reduction in emissions of air pollutants that are often co-emitted with these greenhouse gases, and that those lead to improvements in air quality and improvements in health. So from that perspective, it was yet again an indication that you can do something about it, and there is opportunity to improve not only the climate, but the air that we breathe.
Okay, Kim, last minute to you. A big climate change conference coming up in Scotland in November. What would you like to see emerge from that?
Well, obviously, as a climate scientist who sees the writing on the wall quite clearly with respect to what's coming down the road and the level of emissions reductions that are required to meet our most ambitious targets globally, I hope to see action across the board. I hope to see a leading role for the United States as, of course, an American myself, but also looking to some of the other key players, China, Canada playing big roles, Australia, stepping up and talking about what can be done, and thinking about also how we might be able to turn to support emerging economies where some of this deforestation is occurring, so that we recognize the critical role for preserving those natural sinks going forward.
Wonderful. I want to thank Kim Cobb and Greg Flato for joining us from Atlanta, Georgia, and Victoria, British Columbia, respectively. Be well, you two, and see you down the road, I hope.
Thanks for having us.
The Agenda with Steve Paikin is made possible through generous philanthropic contributions from viewers like you. Thank you for supporting TVO's journalism.